All right, so let's talk about nerves. So we did ulnar nerve, we did median nerve, and I actually had a great question from Beatrice. I'm actually gonna share her question right now because she had a question on ulnar nerve. And I want you guys to think about it like this, right? So she has an injury with a 33-year-old male patient of hers that he's a medical doctor studying to be a plastic surgeon. Funny enough, this is our topic. He had the injury back in May of 2020. He sustained a deep laceration proximal to the wrist. So she sent me a picture. And the laceration was right here. So you see the laceration very ulnarly. Lacerated the ulnar nerve, the artery, and the median nerve had a partial repair as well. So he injured both nerves. So if you have the ulnar nerve and then you have your median, right? So when you're thinking high and thinking low, this would essentially be like a low one, right? Because it's below the elbow. So any muscle, any nerve above that innervated certain muscles over here, so those muscles will still work. Anything below that laceration won't work. So this is a partial. But I believe this is a full, right? So already in your mind, you would be thinking of like what his potential problems are gonna be, right? Now I'm not sure, I believe this is in his dominant hand. Dominant hand, and I'm gonna make assumptions that his dominant hand is his right hand, right? So already you should be thinking about setting expectations. So already you'd be thinking, okay, well, which nerves are innervated by the ulnar nerve. You're thinking about the hypothenar muscles, right? It's all your small finger muscles. You're thinking about certain intrinsic muscles, right? Which is gonna affect the grip. Right, because the hand, the ulnar two fingers does all the power grip for you. So when you start thinking through the muscles, you're gonna know that he has decreased grip strength, right? And then also that ulnar nerve, remember, crosses, and it's a thumb adductor. So he's gonna have a certain problem with pinch. Okay, so we already know when you have a full nerve laceration that like it's like turning the lights off to the muscles, right? So one of the things that they do is when they repair it, it's like a jigsaw puzzle. They're trying to match the fibers back up. It's like bundles inside bundles inside bundles, right? Think of electric wiring, right? Bundles inside bundles inside bundles, and they're trying to match it up. They're so small, but they're gonna try to match it up as close as possible, right? As close as possible. But what happens when you cut something? What are some of your problems? Your problems are gonna be it's not fully matched. Right? Your other problem is going to be scarring. You're gonna have internal scarring, right? And that scarring there is going to stop the flow of electricity further. When you have a compression, once there's a certain amount of nerve death, you can't get that back, right? Now, if you release it and there's a certain amount of return, the nerve has a certain amount of regeneration, right? And so it's going to regenerate a certain amount, but certain parts that died, like, stay dead. It's not like Pet Cemetery. You just can't, like, oh my, I think I just aged myself. Does anyone know who Pet Cemetery is? Like, bury the little dead animal and it comes back to life. That's not what happens, right? Certain amount of it dies, it's dead. And what you're doing is you're just waiting. It's, in a way, it's like a waiting game for how much you're going to get. In the meantime that you're waiting for a certain amount to return, you've got to keep the joints protected so that it has a chance, right? So that it has a chance. But not fully matched with scarring are the two main things that is going to interrupt how well the nerve can regenerate. It's just the nature of the game. So compression is one, traction is another, and then laceration is the worst ulnar nerve type of injury you could have, right? Now, the median nerve goes to the thumb. It affects the thumb quite a bit, right? So it goes to a lot of thumb muscle. So both of these in the low aspect have a lot of intrinsic muscles, intrinsic muscle issues. So intrinsic muscles, whether you're talking about your interossei, your lumbricals, they all help to flex the MP and extend the IP. So at some point, he is now May, so that's about six or seven months. So he is halfway through his recovery, right? He's halfway through his recovery. He has claw hand, right? He has edema of his hand and forearm. This is impaired sensation of the fourth and fifth digits. He doesn't have any problems in the back. Why? Because that's a radial nerve. So the median nerve comes to these three fingers, but it goes to the tips of the nails. After that, on the dorsum of the hand, that's the radial nerve. So that would be fine. His middle finger presents with flexion of his fingers, which is good. So he has the best possible chance here because it was only a partial. So he has the best possible chance of a median nerve and an ulnar nerve laceration is probably one of the worst injuries that you have because both nerves affect how functional you can be. So he's able to have a certain amount of grasp and release. He's progressing well. He's wasting away in the first dorsal interossei. Yeah. That's thumb adduction, it's fine. It's expected. He's able to oppose to all the fingers, the weakness except for the fifth digit he can't. It's because he can't rotate. So hypothenar muscles in the ulnar, he can't rotate, he can't oppose. So to have opposition work, you have to be able to rotate the thumb and you have to be able to rotate the small finger. Both have to work in order to oppose, and this is full opposition. So he having to use different treatment techniques as dynamic splinting to get the fingers to extend during the day. Anti-claw splint. You're doing therapy, you're doing rubber bands, you're stuck and frustrated with the muscle wasting. Well, first of all, one of the things that I would say is don't be frustrated with the muscle wasting, because if you're frustrated, he's frustrated, and then y'all frustrated for no apparent reason, right? You have to set the tone of what someone should expect. And let's be realistic here. I don't care if they put your nerve together. There is a certain amount of atrophy, and once that atrophy sets in, it's not going to come back fully. So you have to set the expectation of of this is potentially what's going to be happening with your hand. What we're gonna do is we're gonna find the muscles that are returning and focusing on the muscles that are returning. And that's going to be your median nerve, right? So I like that he doesn't have a numbness there, right? So you didn't mention anything about numbness. So I would assume that he is doing pretty well with that. So I'd have to look and say, okay, what's the median nerve? What's the median nerve is the abductor pollicis brevis, right? The opponens pollicis, which we're hearing that it works. The superficial head of the flexor pollicis brevis, right? So that's coming. And the first and second lumbricals, right? So he can do this, right? And he should be able to do this with these fingers because it was cut low enough that his profundus and his superficialis is working and his flexor pollicis longus, thank goodness, right? Thank goodness that, because without the flexor pollicis longus, he wouldn't be able to do any of that, right? So we gotta focus on what can you do, and you have to set the tone for like, we're going to be working on the things that we see work best, and we're gonna make those strong, we're gonna make it as functional as possible, knowing that the ulnar nerves may not have as great of a chance, right? And so the biggest thing here is that you need to make sure that the joints are supple, right? There is no need for a night splint as long as the joints move really well. So if he doesn't have joint stiffness, he shouldn't have that problem. The best thing that you could do is put him in an anti-claw splint and encourage him to wear that all the time during the day. It's the best way to be functional, but it's the best way to give the fingers a chance to be in the best position so that when the nerve, as it recovers, it can work. Right? That's the biggest thing, wearing an ulnar nerve, and you're gonna wear that anti-claw splint for a long time. We're halfway through your recovery. So what we really need to do is I need you to keep using your hand as much as possible, right? We need to wear that splint so that you can use your hands. Whatever partial amount of muscles come back, we want to encourage it to get stronger, right? Nerves regenerate very slowly, 1 millimeter a day, going from proximal to distal as it regenerates, right? And it's gonna get stuck along the way. So because here, we're just gonna make sure that everything's moving. I always talk about how the skin and the fascia move. It doesn't just move in flexion, it doesn't just move proximally and distally. In the forearm, there's a lot of rotation as well. So you can't do anything about the internal scarring. What you can work on is the external scarring. Like the bundles that they put in, you can't go in there like, oh, come on, let's do it. You know, you can't massage and move that scar. But that bundle is going to be wrapped down in scar. And what you don't want is a compression of that nerve that might potentially slow its healing. So you definitely want to make sure that the wrist is moving, the forearm is moving, and that whole scar. There should not, 6 months from the injury, we shouldn't be talking about edema. If he's got edema in his hands, he's stuck somewhere here, and you've got to make sure that the whole arm is moving, the forearm is moving, the wrist is moving, so he can be more functional in his hands, right? So all the joints should be as loosey-goosey as possible. Because if the joints are stuck, then I don't care how much return, that muscle is not going to be able to pull past a really stiff joint. Does that make sense to everyone? How I'm describing it? I know Beatrice is not on the call. Right? So you've always got to think about like the type of injury you have so you can set your patient up so that they can really understand like what they're gonna be faced with. He may not be a plastic surgeon. He may be a different type of doctor. Okay, because you know, you're losing a lot of fine motor stuff. especially with both nerves being injured. It's a devastating injury, right? There's no going around that. So we have to set up those expectations for our patients.